coming.
Will everyone please rise for the colors of the United States Capitol Police Ceremonial Unit? Please remain standing for the national anthem performed by Nicholas Brown, music specialist at the Library of Congress, and while the chaplain of the United States House of Representatives, the Reverend Patrick Conroy, pronounces the invocation.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Let us pray. God of heaven and earth, from the beginning of time, your word has brought into existence all that is and all that will be. It is by the power of words that we name all things, communicate toward the building of community, and judge things to be life-giving or death-dealing. Those who cradle our words hold a special place in civilization. Wisdom is passed down and referenced time and again to the benefit of all our lives. We thank you this day for the vocation Dr. Carla Hayden has followed and the sacred trust she will today be assuming to hold the words of this nation in trust as the Librarian of Congress. Bless her with many years of service, and may she be assured of the complete support of Congress and the people of the United States. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Please welcome the Chairman of the Committee on Rules and Administration of the United States Senate and the Chairman of the Joint Committee of the Library, the Honorable Roy Blunt.
Well, good afternoon, and on behalf of the Joint Committee on the Library that seldom has events like this one, I'm honored to welcome you to the swearing-in of Dr. Carla Hayden, and to greet the employees of the Library of Congress, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, my colleagues in the House and Senate, and of course the family and friends of Dr. Hayden, particularly her proud mother, Mrs. Colleen Hayden, who was here for the confirmation hearing in April and has lots of reasons to be proud of her daughter today. You know, over 200 years ago, when the Library of Congress was created, our founders really charged the Joint Committee of the Library and the Librarian of Congress to collect and curate a diverse compilation of literary works for the education and use of members of Congress. Even then, they knew that members of Congress didn't know nearly all they needed to know. Since then, so many other people also take advantage of this collection, but when you really take any time at all to look through the Library of Congress's vast collections or visit any of the library reading rooms, you get a sense of the importance that our founders and those who followed have placed on meeting that original mandate, ensuring that our shared cultural experience is preserved and made available to future generations through this magnificent institution. Anybody who's been here almost always leaves saying this is the unheralded jewel of the Library of Congress, so well managed for so many years by Mr. Billington, who's here today. The library's first collection was largely destroyed during the War of 1812 and was then replaced by purchasing Thomas Jefferson's own personal library. From that relatively small but big for the time personal library, we've gone to where now it's the world's largest collection of books and printed materials, of films, of maps, of sheet music, of sound recordings. This couldn't have been accomplished without the guidance of the nation's chief librarians. The first Joint Committee on the Library of Congress was also the first Joint Committee of Congress, and only 13 times previous today have they been able to witness the swearing in of the Librarian of Congress. Each of those individuals brought a unique perspective to this position and took steps to expand the library's collections and how people all over the world and people in our country would share that collection. The 13 previous librarians have included a medical doctor, an editor, a journalist, a printer, a poet, a political scientist, a historian, two clerks of the House, two lawyers, and two individuals who actually had library experience. In fact, the longest serving librarian of the Congress, who became the librarian at the turn of the 20th century and led the library through World War I, the Great Depression, right up till the eve of World War II, served longer than anyone else and had been a lifelong library administrator. I have no doubt that our 14th librarian, Dr. Carla Hayden, with her experience in library management, with the importance of access to information, will further the work of her predecessors and leave an important mark of her own on the Library of Congress and the unique opportunity and challenge the library faces at a time when there's more information, more accessible in more ways than any of her predecessors would have dream possible when they took this assignment. Dr. Hayden, it's an honor for all of us to be here with you today.
librarianship was really an adventure for me to find out that there is a profession that was dedicated to making books and reading and knowledge available to people. And that just seemed ideal. The confirmation process was really an eye-opener for me in so many ways, because I got to meet legislators that were committed to not only the nation's history, but making information available. And that was just a wonderful thing that made me very pleased that I was confirmed. Well, my vision for this library is very simple, that people will realize that they have a national treasure and that it is part of their heritage, and everyone can find something in the Library of Congress, produced by the Library of Congress, that relates to their lives or where they want to go. What I hope to accomplish with the dedicated staff of the library in the next 10 years of the appointment is to really make more of the collections accessible in various formats. And if we can say that we have collections in the next 10 years that have never been seen digitally and that are used and that are tied in with curriculums around the country, and that people are going to, at the end of 10 years, if people are thinking of the Library of Congress as a go-to place in the stratosphere, really, for information and resources, that I think will be quite an accomplishment.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Speaker of the United States House of Representatives, the Honorable Paul Ryan.
In 1815, as Senator Blunt just mentioned, Thomas Jefferson sold most of his library to Congress, partly because he was a patriot, but mostly because he was broke. The British had burned the original Library of Congress when they invaded Washington the year before. And though a later fire destroyed most of Jefferson's books, we still have some of them. They make up the heart of the library that we have here today. Jefferson, as you know, was a very, very unique man. Other people arranged their books alphabetically or by size. He divided his library into three sections that corresponded with the three main faculties of the mind: memory, reason, and imagination. And when you stop to think about it, those are the very same qualities that define Dr. Hayden. First is a librarian herself. She has the institutional memory necessary to run the largest library in the world. That's a long way of saying she's a pro. She knows what she's doing. Second, she understands the need to bring the library into the digital age. We have millions of documents that almost nobody knows a thing about. It would be a shame if they were lost to the world out of mere inconvenience. But it's that third quality, imagination. That's what I think is so important. We all think of America as this great land of promise, the place where people from all walks of life could get their start, whether they're farming the frontier or working in a factory. But the public library itself is the icon of opportunity. It's a safe haven where people can go to learn and to feed their ever-hungry imagination. I think of the writer James Baldwin. James Baldwin, as a young man, would go to the library and read every book he could get his hands on. When he was done, he'd bring books home with him, and there he'd be, holding a younger sibling in one arm and a book in the other. What would have happened to James Baldwin if there had been no public library? A great mind would have been starved of its essential material. Nobody knows this better than Dr. Hayden. She was widely praised for keeping open her library during Baltimore's unrest last year. But for her, it was the only real choice, the obvious thing to do. And she really seems to come from really sturdy stock. One day when her 83-year-old mom, when she told her mom that she was heading to the library, which was right in the middle of all this chaos, all this trouble, her mother replied, "Oh, make sure you have some coffee." Our next librarian is an accomplished woman, and I have every confidence that she is going to make us all very, very proud. Jefferson once said, "I cannot live without books. Neither can we." The Library of Congress is our national treasure, and with Dr. Hayden at the helm, I know it is in excellent hands. Congratulations.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Chief Justice of the United States, the Honorable John Roberts, to administer the oath of office. Please also welcome Dr. Hayden's mother, Mrs. Colleen Hayden.
Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Carla Hayden, do solemnly swear.
I, Carla Hayden, do solemnly swear.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
And I will well and faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office on which I am about to enter.
The duties of the office about which I am about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Senior Senator of Maryland, the Honorable Barbara Mikulski.
Good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to be here to have the high honor and privilege of introducing Dr. Hayden to you. Wow, but with this crowd, you all know her, you're ready to cheer her on, and you want these speeches to be over so you can hear from her. Well, first of all, greetings to all of you who've come from Baltimore and from around the nation, other professional librarians. And I want to acknowledge that there are other members of the Maryland delegation that are here. My colleague, Senator Ben Cardin, Congressman Elijah Cummings, and John Sarbanes is here. We have all three senators here. Well, we'd like to have three senators anyway, but, and of course, Nancy Pelosi, though she is elected from California, we know her heart is in Little Italy in many ways. And Nancy, I understand that after school, you used to go to the library right on the Outer Banks of Little Italy, am I correct? Yes, and so did I in Highlandtown. Well, for us libraries in Baltimore, were a great thing because they were our gateway to the world. And it is the spirit of the United States of America, one led by the Carnegie and other philanthropists, that felt that access to knowledge and education would be the key to the success of our democracy, that we would have public schools for education and inspiration, public institutions, public schools, and public libraries, that it didn't matter what zip code you were born in, what was the income of your family, you would have access to a school and you would have access to a library. Wow, what a tremendous vision. And here in our own country, when the founders came and were busy writing the Constitution, trying to decide what would be the Missouri Compromise, et cetera, and they were pondering, I'm sure that the ladies, who were also encouraging to be included in this, or they would ferment their own revolution, encouraged a library. Senator Blunt gave our history so well, and Congressman and others have spoken about Dr. Hayden, but know that the first Library of Congress was directly across from the old Senate chamber, so that members of Congress literally could walk across the hall and use the library. Because why? We knew that members of Congress wouldn't know everything. Write that one down. Wouldn't know everything. That there would be people who knew more, said it better, and perhaps maybe gave us new ideas to lead this country into its future and its destiny. That's always been the spirit of the library. In all of American history, only 14 have served. And Dr. Hayden will be the 14th. When Valerie Jarrett called me and said, the president is thinking about nominating Carla Hayden to be the next head of the Library of Congress, what do you think? I said, wow, that's like bringing Cal Ripken back to the Orioles. This is fantastic. You couldn't do better. What I said was, she's professionally accomplished. She's been the head of the National Library Association. She has essentially been peer reviewed by other librarians and received numerous awards. And in Baltimore, she took over one of the most distinguished public municipal libraries, the Enoch Pratt. And working with her able board of directors, she helped, number one, lead it through creating financial stability, making sure that we maintain not only the big downtown library, but that we had branches open and accessible in neighborhoods where families and children and senior citizens needed to do it. And along the way, she also brought the Enoch Pratt into the digital age, and now has led the effort with her board and an able committee to raise the money for the renovation of the Enoch Pratt. She literally, through working with others in a collaborative way, which I know she will be do here, she literally brought the Enoch Pratt into the 21st century. She will do that here. She is an inspirational leader. She's a transformational leader. But she also knows that the library is here for the people. Speaker Ryan talked about our recent troubles, and boy, did we have them during the uprising. But when the schools were closed, Dr. Hayden kept the library open. Right down at a neighborhood we called Ground Zero, on one side of the street was a CVS that had been burned out. But across the street was the Enoch Pratt Library branch that was open. CVS had been burned out, but the lights kept burning open with light in the Enoch Pratt. Ben and I and others of the delegation used that library to have community meetings, and Elijah, to have community meetings. When the Secretary of Education came, when Secretary Visalak came, where could we have our meetings where people would feel comfortable in coming? It was at the library. And when you walked in that library, during that time of trouble and tension, there were kids reading, there were kids studying, there were people on the computers trying to find a job and to try to link in with what a possibility could be. She kept it open. And she also brought a new innovation to the library. It's called Lawyers and Libraries. We passed laws in Maryland that did criminal justice reform. There was the possibility of getting your criminal record streamlined and even in some instances, parts of it expunged because of errors in the whole process. In the neighborhood where they filmed The Wire, which is one of the toughest, most hardscrabble neighborhoods in Baltimore, on the Saturday morning where Lawyers and Libraries was introduced, 600 primarily men, all African-American men, stood in line to meet with a pro bono lawyer or a paralegal to help them work their record through so they could re-enter, not only re-enter society, but get a job in the job market. As they went through that process, 600, at the end, they met with the librarian who said, "Hi, would you like a library card?" Well, I hear that day that strong men, men who'd been through a lot in their life, could not believe that they were given a library card. "You mean you trust me to take a book out?" "Yes." "Do you mean I can come in here at any time?" "Yeah, here's the computers if you're going to be looking for a job." "This is what the library means?" The answer was yes. All of those innovations came from Dr. Carla Hayden. But what does that mean now to the Library of Congress? We don't do programs like that. Well, you know what? This library is now in the process of transforming itself. Libraries are redefining itself. But what we know is we go back to the founding principles of our country. Public institutions made available to the public for their use to empower themselves. And I know that Dr. Hayden will work very closely with the Congress on some of the reforms that are necessary and some of the new transformational ideas that she will bring. I think President Obama made a great choice in Dr. Hayden. And your mother, Colleen, we want to say hello to you, a teacher and educator in her own right. But I want you to know that the gift from Baltimore, you've had a lot of us, from Pelosi to Sarbanes to Cardin and all of us, but the real gift will be that Dr. Hayden will really take this Library of Congress, which will be, I will assure you, will, as over the next days and months, become the Library of Congress for the American people. Thank you, and I'm going to bring Dr. Hayden up so that she can tell you her own great story.
Thank you, Senator Mikulski, for your very kind introduction. Your 39 years of service to the state of Maryland and to the United States Congress is a shining example of dedicated public service. I am also extremely grateful for your personal friendship. It's meant so much to me. Mr. Speaker, I'm honored by your remarks and your presence here today, your commitment to the nation through public service, and your respect and admiration for this library are so appreciated by the staff, and especially by me. Mr. Chief Justice, there is no greater distinction than to be sworn in by you as Librarian of Congress. I want to thank you for your regard for this institution and its role as a source of knowledge and information for the country. I'd also like to acknowledge Chairman Blunt and the Joint Committee on the Library, the oldest continuing joint committee of the United States Congress. Your belief in the library's mission builds on the steadfast and historic partnership between Congress and its library. Thank you so much for your continued support. Now, I must admit that it is hard for me to imagine the little 8-year-old girl with pigtails who checked out a book called Bright April over and over and over again until the fines came in, that she is standing here today. And it feels like yesterday when I began my career at a storefront branch of the Chicago Public Library and watched Judy Zucker on the floor leading story time for children with autism. Watching her interact with the children and in turn seeing their reactions demonstrated the power and potential of a librarian's work. And 40 years later, it is an honor to be nominated by President Obama and confirmed by the United States Senate to lead one of the greatest institutions of our nation. I am truly grateful and humbled by this selection. Now, some people have noted that I am making history as the first woman and the first African American in this post. And that is true. Library pioneer Melville Dewey often encouraged women to enter the profession because they can, quote, bear pain, and could, quote, perform monotonous tasks without boredom. But also, and most poignantly, people of my race were once punished with lashes and worse for learning to read. And as a descendant of people who were denied the right to read, to now have the opportunity to serve and lead the institution that is the national symbol of knowledge is a historic moment. Many people have been part of my journey, family, friends, and colleagues, many of them here today, too numerous to mention by name, but I thank all of you for the life lessons you've taught me and the memories we share, all of which have shaped my experience. I do want to thank my mother, who, among many gifts, introduced me to reading, music, and public service. It is very, very special that she is here today with me as I embark on a new chapter that brings all of those passions together. To have her join me on stage and hold the Bible that belonged to Abraham Lincoln was a special moment for us. My family is from Illinois, and many of my family members are buried in the same cemetery as the 16th president. I want to thank the United States Congress for building and sustaining this library. I appreciate seeing so many of you here today from both houses and both parties. This library is your library, and its service to Congress remains the core function of the institution. The library is also one of the greatest gifts and legacies the Congress has given to the American people. The vision of a national library to serve members of Congress and the communities they represent continues the legacy of my 13 predecessors. Over time, these leaders have expanded the scope of the materials collected, advocated successfully to bring the federal copyright system here, and one by one, overseeing construction of the facilities necessary to house and preserve the collections and services offered. For over two centuries, each librarian's experiences and contributions reflected the country's social and historical landscape, and all have advanced the progress of the library. The sixth Librarian of Congress, Ainsworth Rand Spotford, famously called it the Book Palace of the American People when this building opened in 1897. But the Library of Congress is so much more than beautiful architecture wrapped around bookshelves. It is, in fact, the second part of Spofford's quote, less often used, that is truly powerful. He called it the book palace of the American people, in which you all have equal rights with me, in which the works of all of you will be welcomed and forever preserved. The 8th Librarian of Congress, Herbert Putnam, described the library as a service outside of the limits of Washington. It is indeed a service to the country at large. And the 13th Librarian of Congress believed wholeheartedly in this idea. Dr. James Billington often talked about getting the champagne out of the bottle, and he made significant progress. I am touched. I am touched that he is here today as Librarian of Congress Emeritus with his wonderful wife, Marjorie. I want to offer you a wholehearted thank you for your graciousness, your service, and the strong legacy that you created. I'd also like to take a moment to acknowledge Deputy Librarian of Congress David Mao and the senior staff of the library. Who are making my transition into this post well-informed and as smooth as it could be. The stewardship of this team on behalf of the library is a shining example of the human assets our nation is so well served by. The staff of the Library of Congress believes in this institution and feels honored to serve as I do. Now today, through the power of technology, thousands around the country are able to watch this ceremony live. This is an opportunity to build on the contributions of the librarians who've come before to realize a continuing national library vision that reaches beyond the limits of Washington. When I contemplate the potential of harnessing the power of technology with the unparalleled resources at the Library of Congress, I am overwhelmed with possibilities. These resources include more than 162 million items on nearly 840 miles of bookshelves. If you stretch these bookshelves from Washington, D.C., along the interstate system, you could travel all the way to Davenport, Iowa, before reaching the end. This library holds some of the world's largest collections, from maps to comic books, founding documents like Thomas Jefferson's handwritten draft of the Declaration of Independence, the full papers of 23 presidents, and the works of Americans such as Samuel Morris, Frederick Douglass, Clara Barton, Leonard Bernstein, Bob Hope, and Thurgood Marshall. Yet, what is the possibilities for those treasures? How are they relevant today? I am reminded of a moment during the unrest in the city of Baltimore in April of 2015. The Pennsylvania Avenue Branch Library was located in the epicenter of those events. But I made the decision to keep the library open to provide a safe place for our citizens to gather. And I was there hand in hand with the staff as we opened the doors every morning. Cars were still smoldering in the streets. Closed signs were hanging in storefronts for blocks, but people were lined up outside the doors of the library. And I remember in particular a young girl coming up to me and asking, "What's the matter? Why is everyone so upset?" She came to the library for sanctuary and understanding. I recently had the opportunity to view one of the latest Library of Congress acquisitions, the Rosa Parks collection, which includes her family Bible, the Bible she carried in her purse, and her handwritten letters. In one such letter, she reflects on her December 1st, 1955 arrest, writing, quote, "I have been pushed around all my life and felt at this moment that I couldn't take it anymore." That letter and all of her papers are now digitized and available online, so anyone, anywhere, can read her words in her own handwriting. They can read them in the classrooms of Racine, Wisconsin, in a small library on a reservation in New Mexico, and even in a library of a young girl in Baltimore looking around as her city is in turmoil. That is a real public service and a natural step for this nation's library, a place where you can touch history and imagine your future. This Library of Congress, a historic reference source for Congress, an established place for scholars, can also be a place where we grow scholars, where we inspire young authors, where we connect with those individuals outside the limits of Washington and help them make history themselves. How do we accomplish this? By building on a legacy that depends so much on the people in this room. Not only the elected officials, who have quite a bit to say about the direction of this institution, but also the staff of the Library of Congress, my new colleagues. Here on the mezzanine, watching in the Madison Hall, the Adams Cafe, the Mount Pilgrim Room, watching in Culpeper, Virginia at the Packford Campus for Audiovisual Conservation, and watching in the National Library Services for the Blind and Physically Handicapped. Public service has been such a motivating factor for me in my life and my career. When I received the call from the White House about this opportunity, they said, "Will you serve?" And without hesitation, I said yes. Throughout my career, I've known that the staff of the Library of Congress is a dedicated and enthusiastic group of public service, and I look forward to working with all of you for the years to come. But we can't do it alone. I am calling on you, both who are here in person and watching virtually, that to have a truly national library, an institution of opportunity for all, is the responsibility of all. That means collaborating with other institutions. That means private sector support and patriotic philanthropy for necessary projects like digitization. That means starting a new dialogue about connectivity to classrooms and other libraries. I cannot wait to work with all of you to seize this moment in history. So let's make history at the Library of Congress together. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Chaplain of the United States House of Representatives, the Reverend Patrick Conroy, and rise for the benediction.
Before I pray, I want to pass on the regrets of the Senate Chaplain, the Reverend Barry Black, who was called away at the last minute, and offer my regrets that I cannot replicate the dulcet tones of his marvelous voice. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, for this opportunity to celebrate the swearing-in of Dr. Carla Hayden as the 14th Librarian of Congress. It is an opportunity for all present and for all of the American people to reflect upon the importance of this greatest of institutions, which today is entrusted to her. May she be confident that her work is a vital thread in the fabric of our nation and appreciated by those gathered here and all Americans. Bless Dr. Hayden, and dear God, bless the United States of America. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain at your seats as the official party departs.